Alexander Green's in the Target Plaza, and they serve grain bowls. And so what they do is they have a variety of mixed greens. They have lentils, brown rice, and white rice. And they put that on top, and then they have meat. So it's like they have meatballs, and they have chicken and different things. And then they have different sauces that you can put on top of it. What's so beautiful about it is how much greens and how much grains that you get in your meal. And you finally get to understand what you're supposed to be eating. Very good price point, too. I think like $9, and it could be made into almost two meals. So I was inspired by that, and I wanted to show you how easy it is to actually do this at home. And a lot of it is just meal prep components that you already have ready to go. So let's get started. So if you haven't been there, definitely try and go. So the benefits are, obviously, you'll save time, you will save money, and you will also, it's better for your health. And so the way that you end up saving money is you aren't eating out. If you're too lazy to cook, you end up probably eating out. And that actually costs more money and is worse for your health. I know, shock. Working in the back of a kitchen, you see things, you know things, and you never want to eat in a restaurant ever again. So it's just kind of those things that you think about. For example, very recently, I'm from Taiwan, and so my mom sends me emails from Taiwan and things like that about trends that are going on. One of the big things that's going on in China and Taiwan is they're saying that you should never eat leftover food. That leftover food is bad for you when you reheat it. Or that you should just not eat leftover food. The theory behind that is that the food that they're using to prepare and cook for you is already at its peak. It's going to go bad. So if you're cooking food that's already pretty, it's on the verge of being bad, and then you're taking it home and storing it in your refrigerator for another 2 to 3 days, it can be really bad for you. So when you go out and eat, obviously if it's like it's lettuce or something, it can last a long time. But if it is something that's cooked and things like that, kind of be aware that the food that they might have used might not have been as fresh as something that you might have had at home. So when you cook things at home, none of it on the PowerPoint, I'm not being recorded, voice recorded. All my PowerPoints will say 3 days. That's just because food laws, the way that most people store food, 3 days is the maximum. But if you're comfortable with yourself and you know your temperature up and your refrigerator is at the right temperature, you know that you cooled your food down, you know that you did all the right steps, 7 days is perfectly fine. You can go up to 7 days. So try, I will always say three, but there are many things that can go up to 7 days, including those salads that you guys are gonna, that I'm gonna show you, or that I made. Okay, so how do you start? Don't try to do a full week, choose 1 day, or 1 week. Is the meal that you feel you lack the most in. So for example, if you feel like you suffer with breakfast, in the sense that you just never have a good breakfast, you don't eat a healthy breakfast. Don't think about lunch, don't think about dinner. Work on meal prepping just breakfast then, and start freezing them. You don't have to think of meal prep as everything needs to be made by hand. Do the research and find good substitutes, good granola bars, good whatever. Healthy options can be considered meal prep. And then if you cook for more than yourself, you gotta ask everybody. I mean, this grain bowl might look good, but your 3-year-old child probably has no interest in eating it. So unless you blend it all together. Writing it down, spreadsheets. I do so for example, this week I had 100 people on Wednesday, and then I was about like 70 today. As much as I tell you to start spreadsheets, for me, I need to write it down. If I write it down, it triggers more in my mind, and I'll actually think of things that I forgot. If it's on a shopping list and it's all pretty and printed out, I sometimes will miss things. So do what's comfortable for you, but starting a shopping list definitely makes it easy. And start with recipes that you like, or that you're familiar with. So what I always tell people to start with, just start with marinara sauce. Just do marinara. Marinara can go far and wide. You can put it on everything and anything, and you can just do a couple things to it, and it can go from India to Thailand. So it's very simple, but pick one thing that you know how to make well, and start playing with those items. All right, so your meal prep phase. So again, you want your spreadsheet ready to go, and choose 1 day of your week. and preferably the day that you're not working. And then cook the thing that takes the longest. So usually your meats or your grains. Grains are one of those things that do really well for a long time. So go ahead and make grains in bulk. Freeze them if you have the room in your freezer. I don't have room in my freezer, so if you do, definitely do that. And then if you don't want to cook your protein, marinate. Freeze it marinated. And that way you can defrost it. Don't keep meat marinating for more than a day. You will disintegrate that meat and it will just be mush inside of it and all mixed up. It's disgusting. So especially if you have something acidic in there, it'll actually eat away at your meat. So if you marinate, put it in the freezer, pull it out, defrost, and then cook it. Again, 3 days or freeze. Defrost meals in the refrigerator for overnight. They might not get completely defrosted, which is completely fine. You can use your microwave and then you can definitely get it to the right temperature. Amazon, all these great places now have a lot of meal prep containers for you guys to buy. Just look for the number 7 and BPA free. I would go as far as buying glass. I would say buying glass is probably the safest option if you're meal prepping. If you freeze, it doesn't expand and go weird places, it doesn't get squashed. And the glass, you can even steam it most of the time. So if you want to re-steam something, you can even use it in glass too. In Asia, we use a lot of stainless steel, and that freezes well, but you can't put that in the microwave. Try not to do that. So, but then also look for things that stack within each other. That usually helps. Costco's got some options, but Amazon definitely has the most. It's something that everybody's doing these days. I work inside a gym. So one of the things we hear the most are the guys who meal prep. And I feel like there's a sense of what meal prepping is, and meal prepping to most people is chicken, broccoli, and rice. That is the majority of meal prepping out there. If that helps you start, do it that way. Do chicken, rice, and broccoli. My cousin, her lunch is that every day of the week because her husband cooks and that's all he makes. But I'm going to give you some variations of that in a little bit that you can do. But you want to make sure you balance your meals. So you want to make sure you have a lot of green, some grain, and a little bit of protein. A lot of grain. We've got 4 ounces. All right. So some hacks that you can do. Spice blends. I used to give you spice blends. I can email them to you if you want. The internet is such a great resource. Pinterest, BuzzFeed, they have this down to a T. In the sense that you can go onto them and they have just pictures of all the spice blends from each country. Maybe just 3 spices. Like for example, for a Mexican dish, I might do cumin, coriander, and chili powder. That would make something taste more Hispanic. Or if I wanted to do something more Chinese, I might add 5 spice powder and coriander and white pepper. So you can do these blends and it'll actually make it taste different, but at the same time you have the same base for everything. The same with sauces. So I made 2 sauces today. I did a green sauce and then a yogurt sauce. Yogurt is amazing in the sense that it can pick up and taste like anything you put into it. So you can take that yogurt and add things to it to make it taste whatever way you want. You want a curry yogurt sauce, do add curry powder straight into it. The other sauce that I did was a green sauce. Cilantro, parsley, and green onions. And that's it. And a vegan mayonnaise, which is pretty much just soy, vegan. But you just mix those and then you can put them on all your food. The sauces last about 3 to 5 days, 7. So if you want, you can keep them for a long time and just pour them on things too as you're cooking. Pre-cooked grains and then beans. I don't know how many people actually use just soaked beans, but you can freeze soaked beans without cooking them. Some people will soak a whole bunch of beans at the same time. Instead of cooking it because you don't have time, you can actually freeze that soaked bean and it'll act the same way as if you wanted to cook it for something else in the future. So freeze that stuff. It actually works pretty well. Make mason jar salad, and I'll give you details on that in a sec. Overnight oats is a great one for those who don't eat healthy breakfast. Just
take a jar, fill it with oats, double the amount of liquid, whether it be milk, water, soy milk, leave it in your refrigerator overnight, and you've got breakfast ready to go in the morning. You can put it in a microwave to reheat if you want it hot, you can eat it cold, but then you can add whatever things you want inside of it. Smoothie packets, if you're big on smoothies, freeze all your fruit with the veggies. Have your liquid ready to go and just dump it into the blender in the morning and you're ready, then you can eat that. And then buy vegetables that you eat raw and cooked. That's really important. So like carrots, bell peppers, things that you're comfortable eating raw and cooked will help because you can do them in two different things then. And you're saving money doing it that way. And invest in a food processor. I don't think I say that enough to people. There's a great sale going on at Costco right now. I think it's $149 for that guy and it's worth it. The other one is the Ninja. I was never big on the Ninja until the food pantry bought. The food pantry has a Ninja, and it actually works really, really well too. So I will give the Ninja credit now. But it's food processor. You can make a bread in a food processor. You can make anything in food processor that you can make in a mixer. So cream as well, but then you just need a handheld mixer. So buy a good food processor, and you don't even need to do the chopping then. If you're okay with non-even pieces of food and things. All right, so I'm gonna give you three methods, three more unique methods of cooking meal prep meals, and you can ask me questions after that. So, sheet pan dinner. I don't know if you've seen these around. If you've got an oven, it's winter, go home, turn on your oven. That's the only thing you need to do. And then you have all these bags of just veggies and meats ready to go, and you just literally throw it onto your cookie sheet. There's different temperatures and for how long, but if you can tell, everything starts over 400. And what that does is it almost seals in the flavor of food. So you're almost like pan searing it, only you're doing it in the oven. So because of the high heat of the oven, it'll almost really, really caramelize and cook the outsides and everything, and then give you the idea that you're cooking it on the pan without doing it. What you can do is you can cheat. I do like chicken thighs with skin on. Turn on your broiler and then you can broil that skin and then it'll get nice and crispy. If you like breaded foods, turn on the broiler and just use a little bit of oil to spray on top of it and then you can get that extra crisp out of it. When you do this, cleanup is super easy too because you can just line the pan with foil and just chuck it all away when you're done. If you don't like using foil, silk hats are really good. And what I would do is keep a couple of them just for dinners. Like you should keep your silk hats, desserts for desserts and savories for savories. They do pick up the scent after a while. And so that's what you do for sheet pan dinners. And you can even do fish now. So I'll email this to you guys too if you want. I'll let you know it tomorrow. Yeah, because you want the temperature. Because it really is. It helps a lot too. And then the last thing is you need to pick vegetables that roast at the same time. So you don't want to mix like a potato with a zucchini. That might be a little bit, but you can do like rutabaga and turnips and potatoes. But try to keep things together that would cook the same amount of time. All right. Now this is my other favorite one. One pot method. Other methods. Some of you have seen this. So you just take one pot and you just fill it up all the way with all the things. So on the bottom, you put grains, quick cooking grains though. So do not put brown rice on the bottom of this. I'll tell you how I made my brown rice today, but do not put brown rice. I'm talking quinoa, the quick cooking farro that they sell at Trader Joe's. Any of those quick cooking grains would work really well. And then a protein on top of that. And then sauce, and then your veggies. And then you just put it in your oven with the lid on, or foil. It needs to be covered so that it can kind of steam and get everything. And then you put your vegetables on top, and that's it. And you just stick it in your oven. You can go ahead and make these pots and stick them in your refrigerator so that all you do is you just take the pot out and put it right into the stove when you're done. You know it's done, so this is the question. How do you know it's done? Our nose is the best way of letting us know when things are done. When things smell aromatic, that means it's done. Baking is one of those ones that really, if you smell it, it's done. You usually don't have to taste it at that point because if you go any further, it'll be burned. So if you smell it, take it off, and you're ready to go. And you can play with different layers. And now, the mason jar salad. So you guys had a the same idea as that. So there's five layers that I usually like to do. Layer one is the dressing. So it can be a creamy dressing, it can be an oil-based dressing, anything like that. And then you would put in your crispy veggies. So for example, your cucumbers, carrots, celery, things like that would go in the next layer. Above that, beans, corns, meats, and other proteins that you don't mind getting a little bit mushy. It might get a little bit mushy on there just because you're gonna put the grains on top. And then you're gonna put the greens right on top of them. And then you can store these 5 to 7 days. So you're ready to go. Use the big pint jars. Don't use the 1.5 pint jars. Use the big ones. Don't cheat yourself and just make a little meal because they're really small then. They're pretty when they're small like that, but use the 1.5. And then make sure the lids are on tight and ready to go. So that's usually how those jar grain salads go. I have a chart of all the ways that you can cook grains if you're interested, so just email me. The recipes are actually out in front of my email address, so feel free to email me if you want more of the charts for spices as well as for the different kinds of grain cooking time. Now, let me tell you, so I'm not going to demo this because it was a lot that we were doing today, but I'm going to talk you through the two recipes that I made. Do I have any questions about meal prepping so far? Yeah.
When you mentioned beans, what do you think about canned beans?
Okay. Canned beans are great. A few things to look for. BPA, lime, is the number one thing. Most of them are BPA lime. And so they're getting better. I'm surprised right now by how many people have switched away from BPA lime. So that's number one. Number two, the sodium content on them. They're really, really high in sodium. Usually, black beans are probably the hardest ones to find without salt. And you know how you always, I don't know if you're, but there are a lot of recipes for vegans specifically that use black beans as a substitute for baked goods. Like you can make black bean brownies, black bean everything, but they have a lot of salt in them. And so you can go as far as soaking canned beans in water overnight to leach some of that extra salt away. But I would say if you do use them, rinse them like you've never rinsed them before. Unless, I mean, I found out the best way to make beans from Freddie, one of my student workers. He showed me how his mom makes beans at home, and he's Salvadorian. And the way that they do it is he opens a can of beans, he sautés some onions and garlic, he dumps the whole can with the juice and everything in there. Oh my God, are those amazing beans. Mm-hmm. They are creamy, they are super seasoned, they taste so good. But then you look at the back of that can and you look at the sodium content, it's crazy. Beans have absolutely no flavor. You have to add that much salt into them for them to taste good. Not only that, they're canned, and so they've been stored longer, so they have to add even more to get that taste. So what I always say is, if you can, buy an Instant Pot or a slow cooker. I haven't gotten my Instant Pot. Okay, so I will admit, I bought the Instant Pot, and I'm on my second one already. It's made a world of difference. If you don't have an Instant Pot, and you want to start cooking at home, I don't think there's a better way to start cooking than to buy an Instant Pot at this point in your life. There is so much that you can do with that thing that everybody can cook. Like, everybody can make a stew that has meat that just falls off the bone, or if you want to do grains, and you want to do grains in an hour, like, it can be done now. And it's amazing how it started. It's the story behind it is amazing. The guy who started the Instant Pot, great marketing scheme. He didn't think that he could just go into stores. What he did was he took all these Instant Pots that he created and he mailed them to bloggers. And he said, hey, you've got a great blog. Try this product out. Give me some recipes that you can do in it. And it just took off. And that was the marketing scheme behind Instant Pot. And so it's a great tool if you don't cook at home, if you live by yourself, if you have a family of 10. Like, there is not a person out there that should be like their infomercial right now. But really, it really is that one great product that I think everybody should have. So the beans then, I would do that, cook it, and store it in the freezer. But if you want, you can get, like Trader Joe's, I think, has some no-salt beans. That would be okay. Yeah, definitely.
So that one pot thing that you said, can you do that in an Instant Pot?
No, it needs oven.
Instant Pot has so many recipes already that it doesn't even, you can do anything that you do in a slow cooker. You can do anything that you, yeah, anything you would do in a slow cooker in an Instant Pot. Or really anything. Like I made spaghetti in there just to try it out. And that doesn't work though. But there are, I've been playing around with it. And so there are different things. And so, does everybody have a copy of the recipe from today by any chance? No? Do I have a cookie for Adam? Some people that came a little bit earlier, I'm just going to pass them down.
Food Safety 101 right there. So when you
cooked food, bacteria obviously will start growing like crazy.
At a good temperature, they like it nice and warm, just like we like it here. So if you can think about that, as soon as your food starts getting cold, or once you take it out, start realizing how, what time it is if you take it out. After 2 hours, it needs to go back into the refrigerator. I don't care if it is still kind of warm. If it's hot, hot still after 2 hours, put it in like an ice bath or something to cool it down. The only reason why you need it cooled down isn't for the food, but it's for the rest of the food inside the refrigerator. Because that hot bowl or whatever will cool down your refrigerator to the point that it will spoil everything in there. The same goes for anything you're freezing too, specifically for if it's too warm or too hot, it'll turn everything around it into mush. So it'll actually soggy, it'll soften everything around it. So you want to make sure that it's at room temperature before you put it in the refrigerator, and at least cold or room temperature before you put it in the freezer. Soups, if you've got a big vat of soup and you just can't cool that thing down, what in the restaurant world, we use sticks of ice. So they were like huge things of ice, and then you would just stir it in there, and then it would cool it down. What you can do is if you have good like BPA-free lined Ziploc bags, fill it with ice and then put it in there. Or any kind of like freeze ice inside a jar and put it in there to help cool it down. But those are all things that will help cool like soups down. When you freeze soups, freeze them in a layer. Like freeze them flat and so that you've got layers and layers of Ziploc bags that are flat as opposed to all weird shapes and everything. So they freeze well, but most things freeze really well. But when your freezer goes, it goes. And so make sure you throw everything away. If your freezer dies on you, throw everything out. Do not try to refreeze that stuff. But I say this.
Try it.
I've been trying this recently. Refreezing, not here, don't worry. Refreezing things that I have defrosted, like meat. For example, a lot of Japanese or Korean supermarkets sell the meats that are thinly sliced, shabu shabu, sukiyaki. They usually store it in the freezer section. And it's just a big chunk of meat then. I only need half of it, and so I actually let it defrost, and then I'll refreeze the rest of it. It hasn't changed the texture that much. Freezing and refreezing is supposed to change the texture of meat. It just gets mushier and mushier. It doesn't cook as well. Play around with it. I've been refreezing some stuff, and I might have a good freezer, but it really hasn't been that bad. So don't throw away all your food. We throw so much away already. So try to do something with it, yeah.
What about the number of times, like, I'm gonna cook on it.
Yeah.
We disagree on that. We'll cook 74 for the whole week, and I'll put it in meat only once, one more time.
Okay.
After that, I know you go again.
I'm on the same page with you. I don't know the scientific, like, I don't know the science behind it, but I agree with that. I don't reheat food more than once. Yeah. It's funny because we'll reheat cook. So you're talking like leftovers, you'll reheat once.
Yeah, so
but then, yeah.
Cook it Sunday or whatever, and then.
I agree with that. I do, but I don't know the science or the health benefits behind it, but it just seems gross after that.
Yeah.
It's just a little. And I mean, I have twins, and so I was using the microwave, was getting to the point where I was using it all the time. I started feeling bad, but if it's easy for you to use the microwave, use it. But if you do have the time, reheat your soups on the stove. Like, just grab a little pot and reheat it. It's not that hard. It's not that much of a dish. But just really, just put it in there, reheat it up in there. It's just a little bit healthier. And if you've got cast iron, I like saying this every time, women out there, cast iron, reheat, cook everything in that cast iron. It is getting that iron into your body that you are lacking. So it is very important for us to cook with cast iron. And it is not messy. It is not dirty. Very easy to use. Lodge makes really good ones, and they sell them right down the street at Ace Hardware. So pick one up. It's worth it.
Any other questions?
But like I have an antique one that my grandmother gave to me. My grandmother was 97, and it's
fried chicken. But she gave it to my mom, and my mom, being Asian, thought she could wash it with soap. So it has had one wash of soap since the passing down, but we definitely try. It's nasty, though. You have to put the paper towel on the bottom of it. It's all greasy, but it has all those flavors inside of it. So cast iron is a good way to cook if you've never done it before.
Will you email us your slide?
Yes, I will email that to her right now, and then she will, oh no.
They're always posted on the Health and Fitness Fridays website.
I will do that.
Same with the videos.
Same with the videos.
We record everything, and we put up the PowerPoints, and we put up the recipes on the Health and Fitness Fridays webpage. If you ever want to see past ones, too.
Does it also have the charts you're talking about?
No. Email me for those. And so if you have email addresses on that bottom of the page, and so just email me, and I can send those to you. But you can just go BuzzFeed, BuzzFix, BuzzFeed, this, and it just all comes up. And so, like I used to give you guys all this information, there's just it's everywhere nowadays that it's not worth it, because I feel like you guys know what you're looking for, but there's many out there. But I will send them to you, you email me. So, thank you guys for coming out.